Professor Sunil Kumar Singh, Director, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, National Institute of Oceanography. Scientists working in this prestigious institution, students, and my dear brothers and sisters. I am delighted to visit this institute and address all of you. After becoming Vice President, I have decided to visit various scientific and research institutions to interact with scientists for a better understanding of the work being undertaken by them and share some of my thoughts also. My dear friends, you are all aware I have been in public life for more than 42 years. Always going around the country, meeting people, greeting people, talking with people, trying to understand the people and their problems and highlight their problems. Now I am no more in politics. I have retired from politics but not tired from public life. That's why I am here before you. And also, after becoming Vice President of the Constitutional Authority, the Vice President's responsibility has certain protocol. So after understanding the protocol, I have decided I must interact with the different sections of the people, know what they are doing, what are their aspirations, what are the problems, what are the challenges, what are the opportunities that are available to the country, and then try to move on. So I have selected 5 sectors. One is students. I have been going around to various universities, interacting with students and professors, the academic community, understanding their problems, challenges, their thoughts. Secondly, I have been going around the country meeting, visiting scientists, research institutes, technology institutes around the country, right from Arunachal Pradesh to Andaman, to Jammu Kashmir to Goa. I have been to a number of institutions so far in the last 16 months, because I always feel the scientist community are doing a great job and they need to be recognized, and also you should really encourage them and also impress upon them that the knowledge that they develop, the technology they develop, ultimately should reach the people. For example, if it is agriculture, lab to land, that is very much required. And that also gives me immense understanding and knowledge of various innovations that are going on, various studies and research that are going on in the country, and the problems, if any, they have. And the third sector I am visiting is the farming community. Agriculture is our basic culture of our country. In spite of urbanization, even now 54% of the people are still living on agriculture and allied activities. We have to make agriculture sustainable, viable. It is facing challenges as of now. So we must go for systemic and also structural changes. Fourth one is about visiting various cultural institutions, because life is not simple material thing. It requires something more. Sometimes people say, roti, kapda, makan, और क्या चाहिए डॉल. तो रोटी कपड़ा मकान बहुत ज़रूरी है, मगर उससे चलेगा नहीं. रोटी कपड़ा और मकान मिलने के बाद भी लोगों का मन में और भी इच्छा होता है. एंड इंडिया इज़ अ कंट्री विथ अ ग्रेट ट्रेडिशन ऑफ आर्ट एंड कल्चर. वी हैव 64 आर्ट्स. सो वी नीड टू एंकरेज दम. द म्यूजिक, डांस, आर्ट, इवन ड्राइंग, painting, so many activities are there. So we should encourage them. In the olden days, you know, Rajas and Maharajas, they used to encourage art and culture. But now, in the modern days, it is the duty of the government, people's representatives, to interact with them, to encourage them, to identify them, to facilitate them, to promote them. And then next is about various public organizations. Confederation of Indian Industry, FICCI, ASSOCHAM, Lions Club, Rotary Club, and various federations, doctors, advocates, chartered accountants, company secretaries, different people, traders, because they're all part of our country. And everybody is doing, they're all shareholders in the developmental story of the country. So we have to really meet them. That's how I'm going around, and then whatever knowledge I get, whatever feedback I get, and I go back to national capital, I try to interact with the concerned minister, and sometimes, if it's so important, and I also brief the president and also the prime minister on certain aspects, whatever comes to my mind and whatever I take notice, we try to pass it on to them, except politics, everything else that way. Because this is an area, politics is an area which is left to the politicians. I'm glad this experience and exposure for the last 18 months I've been as the vice president is really making me more knowledgeable. Because I always believe that everybody should learn. The country is huge. The world is large. The problems are multidimensional. The work is that's going on in the country in the various fields is immense. So one has to understand and also develop his or her knowledge. So that's why I say to all, including politicians, learn, learn, learn before you yearn, yearn, yearn. And the learning is a continuous process. Today, I feel after coming over here and after meeting the scientists, seeing their presentation, I got really enriched. My understanding has comparatively gone up. I can't say I have become an expert after spending a few hours here, but I have got the basic knowledge and understanding what is happening on the seafront, the oceanography, what is the progress made, what are the opportunities still, and what are the challenges that you people are facing. In different, I have been going around, as I told you, to a number of institutions. That's really making me very happy, and I'm sure after visiting various institutions that the future of India is strong and we have a bright future. I'm glad to interact with all of you and get a deeper appreciation of the excellent work being done by you. Oceans are vital importance for the wealth and the well-being of present and future generations. They hold the 97% of the planet's water, while 2% is found in glaciers and ice caps, and only 1% comprises Earth's fresh water. We are aware of the fact that oceans produce more than 50% of the world's oxygen and absorb 40% of the carbon dioxide, buffering the impact of the global warming, underlines the crucial role played by them. Thus, they help in regulating the global climate. Oceans cover 72% of the surface of our blue planet and provide humankind with food, minerals, energy, fresh water, and oxygen. They regulate climate emission, absorption, and shoreline protection, and support livelihoods as well as job creation. Indeed, oceans are our life support system. Currently, it is estimated that more than 3 billion people depend on marine and coastal resources for their livelihood. I come from a coastal state, Andhra Pradesh. I know how the people's lives are interlinked with the marine activity. Enhancing more than 80% of global trade, marine and coastal environments constitute a key resource for economic development. Considering the importance of oceans on the life and sustenance of humanity, the United Nations has taken steps to declare the period 2021 to 2030 as a decade of ocean science for sustainable development. Further, the Sustainable Development Goal 14, SDG, what we call, 14 proposed by United Nations, which deals with life below the waters, emphasizes the importance of oceans in moderating and sustaining life. With this background, it is very important to prioritize our efforts in ocean science and technology to achieve the national goal of transforming India to be the third largest economy in the coming 10-15 years. Some people are saying and arguing also, already we are the third largest economy. Okay, no problem on that. The entire world is looking to India. I have been to different countries earlier as minister, now even as vice president, I interact with them, I go around. I've been to Latin America, Central America, I've been to African countries, I've been to Europe, USA. I'm going to go to the South Asian countries shortly. The understanding is that everywhere there's a great amount of enthusiasm about India, interest about India. Respect and recognition for India has gone up. Once upon a time, India was known as Vishwa Guru. Students from across the globe, they used to come to Nalanda, Takshashila, Pushpagiri to study here. Not only we, our Indian historians, they have not written much about India because we were under colonial rule. But Hua Hian, Yuan Song, the Chinese historians, they came and they wrote about the greatness of India also. But today, once again, the future belongs to India, that is Bharat. Thanks to the knowledge and intelligence of people like you and many who are working in various fields, up to agriculture even. And today, everywhere, people want to come and invest in India. For two reasons. One is business, the reforms that have been undertaken, the atmosphere that is created, the stability that is provided, and second, and opening up, we have opened up now. And the second is out because of our culture and civilization. People are highly appreciative of our culture and civilization because we are one of the oldest civilizations. We never attacked any country. I have been to Latin American countries. I have interest always to ask people about their mother tongue, whether they are promoting it or not. Many of them, they do not know their mother tongue. I ask them, what happened to you? They said, sir, we were under Spanish and our language got vanished. The colonial rulers, if you go by the history, they first try to attack our culture, destroy our culture. Destroying easy by destroying the language. British has also tried. They made English as a qualification for the jobs because of our size, our culture, and wisdom of our people, they could not succeed. Of course, now, because of the education system, we are getting tempted to go to that side and then forget our own mother tongue. Mother tongue is very essential. Original thoughts, you will be able to articulate better in your mother tongue. Bhasha aur bhavana ek saath chalta hai. That's why I always say I have taken it as a mission to educate the youngsters around the country to focus on their mother tongue, practice mother tongue, promote mother tongue, respect mother tongue. When you are respecting mother tongue, you are not against other languages. You must learn as many languages as possible. Nothing wrong. Germans are doing research on our Sanskrit and our Vedas and our Upanishads. They are showing interest. And we are neglecting our own languages. After becoming Rajya Sabha chairman, the vice president has a dual responsibility. One is the constitutional authority. Second is the chairman of the Rajya Sabha. So I made it now felicitated that people can speak in any of the 22 languages in their mother tongue, in Rajya Sabha. There will be simultaneous translation. That is having a positive effect. Because I say to our youngsters, mother tongue is like your eyesight. Other languages are like spectacles. If you have eyesight, then spectacles will work. If you don't have eyesight, even if you wear Ray-Ban glass, you will not have any sight. Forget about foresight. So mother tongue is essential. Whether it is Konkani, Goan, Marathi, Punjabi, Assami, Telugu, Tamil, Kannada, Malayali, Kashmiri, Dogri, Urdu, whatever it is. We should promote it at home. Should not be tempted by this craze for other language. But at the same time, we must learn as many languages as possible to enhance our knowledge. I don't know many of you have seen or not, when a foreign dignitary comes, meets the president, prime minister, or even vice president, there will be a person sitting next to man or woman. They will not be speaking in English, even if they know English also. They will be speaking in their language and there will be a translation. आई आस सुषमा स्वराज जी बिफोर आई बिकेम वाइस प्रेसिडेंट, क्या सुषमा जी लोगों को अंग्रेजी मालूम नहीं क्या? शी सेड मेनी ऑफ देम नो इंग्लिश बट दे डोंट स्पीक, दे फील इट इज सेल्फ रेस्पेक्ट, दे वॉन्ट टू स्पीक इन देयर मदर टंग ओनली एंड देन ट्रांसलेशन. दैट इज द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ द लैंग्वेज, वन हैज टू अंडरस्टैंड. कमिंग बैक टू व्हाट आई हैव बीन ट्राइंग टू एक्सप्लेन, द वर्ल्ड नाउ लुक्स टू इंडिया, कल्चर, हेरिटेज, सिविलाइजेशन. Because we believe in Sarve Jana Sukhino Bhavantu, we never attacked any country, in spite of having 27% of the GDP, world at times. Babylonia, Egypt, Roman, Greek civilization, they are also old, but where are they today? India is still moving forward because we believe in Sarve Jana Sukhino Bhavantu. Share and care is the core of Indian philosophy. We never harmed anybody. All others, Tam, Dick and Harry, came and attacked us, ruled us, ruined us, rooted us, cheated us also. Because I did not explain to you, Goa has been a victim of colonial rule. You are all here. So, but India, in spite of the size, in spite of the past, in spite of knowledge, we never attacked any country because we believe in Sarve Jana Sukhina Bhavantu. The knowledge which we are acquiring here, which you people are acquiring, are adding to the treasure of the knowledge of the country, is not to conquer anybody, but to see that we pass on the knowledge to the humanity, to make life of the people more comfortable. The purpose of research, science, is to make the life of the people more comfortable and happy. Comfort and happy, there is a difference. Prosperity and happiness, there is a difference. You may have so much prosperity, so much money, and you have diabetic. You can't eat anything. You have so much prosperity, but you have problems. You have worries. So you cannot be happiness. So happiness is something more than that. So we want the people to live in happiness. So my dear friends, the World Bank, the World Economic Forum, the International Monetary Fund, the Asian Development Bank, Moody's Ratings, all international agencies are saying, if India moves with this speed and continue the reforms, it will become the largest economy, one of the largest economy, third largest economy or whatever it is. So that being the case, we must all add to the wealth of the nation, we must all add to the health of the nation, we must all work towards taking care of climate change, we must all work towards making new innovations, investigations, research, and come out with new livelihood opportunities, better facilities, and enhance the income of the common people. With this background, it's important to prioritize our efforts in ocean science and technology to achieve the national goal of transforming India to be the third largest economy in the coming few days. I'm happy that CSIR, National Institute of Oceanography, an autonomous body of the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, is doing research on different aspects of ocean, such as the impact of climate change, marine biodiversity, coastal hazards such as coastal erosion and storm surge, marine hazards like tectonics and slumping of seabed. I understand foundation of ocean science is mostly based on observations. To take up ocean observation studies, scientists like you need appropriate tools and platforms. I'm told that research vessels are an ideal platform to do ocean observation. Research vessels and their equipment represent a significant technological asset also. Along with this, you are also doing archaeological, marine archaeological, this thing. That's also very important. Dwaraka, which was submerged. Or the other things you have done in Puducherry, or in Lakshadweep, or even in Goa. These are all going to add to the nation's knowledge. Archaeology, the other day, only 3 days back, I was sharing with a scientist, 3 days back, Professor B.B. Lal, I had an occasion to release his book, his volumes, and also felicitate him. He is 98 years old. But man is healthy. Came to the dais, he was talking to people at my house in Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Bhavan. without any problem, remembering each and everything without reference to notes at the age of 98. The amount of knowledge I was so impressed. So our culture, Harappan civilization, Mohenjo-daro civilization, the other civilizations and all, you must have all this, because a country which forgets its past, its history, its heritage, it can never progress. So this archaeological survey also is equally important. I am glad two dedicated ocean-going vessels, RV Sindhu Sankalp and RV Sindhu Sadhana, are managed by CSIR NIO. With these two dedicated vessels, I am sure that CSIR NIO will be able to carry out all the relevant studies in India's exclusive economic zone, which constitutes 2/3 of our land area. From the presentations made to me by different scientists, I understand that CSIR NIO is playing a major role in understanding the science of the North Indian Ocean, such as dynamics of its circulation, basin-wide biogeochemistry, and tectonic framework of basin evaluation. I am informed that the efforts of CSIR NIO led to establishing India as a pioneer in polymetallic nodule mining, with an allocated mining site of 75,000 square kilometers in the Central Indian Ocean. I am glad that CSIR NIO helped to prepare India's claim for regal continental shelf with an area of about 1 million square kilometers. And this institute launched India's Antarctic research program in the early 1980s. I am also happy to note that CSIR NIO provides specialized services to society in addressing ocean-related problems. In addition to its planned research projects, I am happy to learn that this institute has successfully carried out more than 1,300 projects funded by oil and gas companies, ports, power plants, chemical industries, municipalities, and industrial estates. I understand that your institute has also carried out marine environmental impact assessment for several prestigious and nationally important developmental projects, such as Seabird Project of Indian Navy at Karwar and others involving offshore prospecting for oil and gas by ONGC, HPCL, IOC, and BPCL, among others. In fact, you must work closely with these organizations. And also with Archaeological Survey of India, exchange of information, sharing the information. Dear sisters and brothers, development along with coast has been increasing over the years. I have been informed that the Government of India has already planned development of ports and allied facilities through Sagaramala. Different coastal economic zones are planned. The Sagaramala project, which seeks to modernize ports through IT-enabled services, is expected to give an impetus to the economy. With India looking forward oceans for the economic growth through the blue economy, important institutions like NIO will have to step up their research in areas such as ocean energy and marine energy. It should be noted that India is meeting most of its oil and gas requirements through imports. Scientists should study the potential of renewable energy derived from the ocean, from wind, wave, and tidal sources. The objective of blue economy is to promote smart, sustainable, and inclusive growth and employment opportunities through maritime economic activities within the Indian Ocean. All of you will agree that India should fully tap the enormous potential of the blue economy to achieve higher economic growth trajectory and initiate appropriate programs for sustainable harnessing of ocean resources, research, and develop relevant sectors of oceanography. However, while pursuing the blue growth, every effort must be made by all the stakeholders, including private and public sectors, to prevent further degradation of the ocean and its ecosystem. It's very important. In view of the global warming, resource degradation, and marine pollution, we have to conserve and sustain our oceans as time is running out. Hence, CSIR, NIO should play a major role through dense ocean observations and high-resolution ocean models over the Indian Ocean to meet the challenges in understanding different ocean processes due to climate change. The institute should also act as a nodal center for blue economy related to research and technology development. There is a need to focus on ocean-centric technology to harness the marine resources economically for sustainable growth of India. development of technologies for deep sea mining, underwater vehicles and underwater robotics for extraction of minerals should be initiated. NIO should also undertake research and development of drugs from the sea. I strongly feel that the focused approach in some of the areas such as minerals from the ocean, energy from the ocean, can make India a global leader and serve our national goals. I was just seeing and was impressed by the study how the climate change, how the course are changing and all. I was also inquiring to the scientists, okay, we are able to understand the changes that are occurring, the velocity and all. But is there a way to stop those changes happening? It's a larger issue. And we need to study. Not only we, the entire world community must make study, because we are seeing the way the climate is changing, how the nature is becoming unpredictable, because we people, not only in India, in different parts of the globe, we started neglecting nature. So that's why wherever I go, I'm telling the people, love and live with the nature. Love and live with the nature. Nature, culture, together for a better future. That's my advice to all. We must preserve the nature. I wish you all the success to each one of you who are all here working in this prestigious institutions, and also wish my best wishes to the staff of the CSIR, National Institute of Oceanography, in your future missions. I'm happy that I have been given an opportunity to come here, interact with some of you, understand, and also convey my thoughts to all of you. All the best to all of you. Thank you very much. Namaskar. Jai Hind.